IVM.
If you enjoy listening to IVM Likes, you should also check out our other show called Seen and the Unseen, a show hosted by Amit Verma, where he discusses topics related to economics, politics, and its impact on our society. New episodes every Monday on the IVM Podcasts app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of IVM Likes.
Woo!
That was me.
That was Jana. So, the only excited soul in the studio. What's up? What's been? How's it going?
It's going great.
I can't believe you moved into the mic.
Woo! There goes again.
How's the festival? Jana was at the music festival in Meghalaya. How was that?
If I'm being honest, it was horrible. If I'm being dishonest, it was amazing.
Oh God!
Yeah, it was terrible.
Let's say something. Hi, Abbas. Abbas is also here with us.
I haven't been on IVM Likes for so long.
No, you were here the last one, right?
Was
the
I?
The one. Yeah.
I haven't been in
you
one.
You haven't
since
been
yeah.
in a long time.
Hey, guys,
yes.
We haven't on the last episode. We discussed celebrity feuds and had a lot of fun talking about them. So please go listen to that episode as well. Today.
But right now, listen to this one.
Yeah, now. Don't stop. You guys, don't stop. Keep listening. Because today we're discussing Homecoming.
Yes.
The podcast that was adapted into a TV series. So that's what we're discussing in the second round. In the first round, we are going to recommend some cool stuff.
Woo!
Janam.
Janam is having a music festival hangover. So she has to do that every Janam, other every sentence.
Janam, stop doing MDMA in the studio. Guys, we do not encourage drug taking. But who wants to go first?
I will.
Okay, go for it.
I have something very exciting to recommend. I binged watched this show. It's called The Haunting of Hill House.
Why are you?
So funny. Oh my God.
Okay. Wait, I've heard of this. It's the one where people scare you.
Yeah. It's a horror show. It's super scary. And it's very intense. It's out on Netflix. All 10 episodes. You can binge watch it like I did.
No way. That's a possibility. Because I attempted watching 2 episodes. And every episode is an hour long.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
All the better. We have 10 hours worth of things to watch.
I wrapped up in like 24 hours. I was done with this show.
Man.
And so apart from the horror element, which is brilliantly portrayed, they also address a lot of real adult problems. So the story revolves around these 5 siblings who grew up in the haunted house, but they moved when they were quite young. But
what time period is the show set in?
In the
current time?
Yeah.
Okay.
But when they were young, they are like 90. It's early 90s.
Like it keeps shifting between 2 timelines.
Yeah. And the kids, when they were in that house, they like experienced certain things. All of them had their own individual experiences. Like some of them saw ghosts, some of them didn't, and some of them didn't believe in it. Some of them were like somewhere on the fence about it. So how like it shows how they all grew up and they've all like moved on with their lives. They're in different settled in different cities with different jobs and professions. And
what something interesting about that show is how all of their most of their people's jobs are super connected to like dead and like dead people.
Yeah.
Or like ghosts. That was quite eerie. Why did they grow up to be such weirdos?
I think that was intentional, just to go along with the whole theme of the
show. Do you want to tell the listeners what are their jobs? I don't think that's a spoiler.
Yeah, so one of them is a writer who kind of fuels this whole sibling.
Who writes about ghosts.
Yeah.
And like ghost stories.
Yeah, and he keeps going back to like, he actually writes about growing up in that house and about all the siblings' experiences and some of them object to it.
Weirdo number one. Number two.
Number two. So the other one is an embalmer. She makes dead bodies not come to life, but makes them look preserves them, makes them look not ghastly and scary.
Yeah.
Okay, so like the scares, the nature of the scares, like is it like creepy horror or is it like jump scares? And
there are a few jump scares. I'd say it's a mix of both. There is creepy horror, there is
it's
jump
actually
scares.
Super weird, just to be honest. One person just keeps seeing like the same kind of things. Like they have a pattern in what they see.
Also, the way the whole show is written and shot is so good, because like every episode you know, addresses every, like, it's focused on one sibling's perspective of growing up and the kind of experiences they've had. Mm-hmm. And then after they're done with the five siblings, then the other episode is about the mom and then the dad.
Mm.
And how they wrap up. Like, it's pretty good.
Yeah, that's true. Like, they don't reveal till quite some time what happened to the mom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. And, like, just the way it's written, it's like you can't really... every episode like reveals a little more than what you knew earlier, and just the way it's done, it's quite good.
It's very gripping, but again, you have to be like Janam, someone who just enjoys putting themselves in a situation like this.
So if you're a fan of horror, or if you, even if you're not a fan, even if you just like out of curiosity you want to watch it, go for it. It's called The Haunting of Hill House on Netflix.
Thank you, Janam.
Thank you.
How are you doing now after that?
I'm looking for more horror things to watch, actually.
Wow. Oh, did you watch the film I told you to watch?
No, what was it?
Under the Shadow.
No, but I have added it to my watch list. Cool. I will check it out.
So I saw, even I'm not someone who watches a lot of horror. I read a lot of horror. I mean, I've read a lot of Stephen King. But I saw Tumbad, and I saw one more horror film at Mami. And I thought, now I can watch horror.
Anything.
And then I watched that film, Under the Shadow.
Yeah. Was it scary?
It was scary as hell.
Did you watch it alone?
I watched it alone, yeah. No, actually, my sister was in the house. But still, it scared the shit out of me.
So you know what? This Haunting of Hill House is based on a novel.
It's based on a novel,
same book, same name.
Which is why I asked you when it's set, because the novel is set in Gothic times in the 1800s. So I think they've revamped it and made it current.
Yeah.
So,
you know what's the worst? Because I was trying to watch this over Diwali with my friends.
Mm.
And the worst is, even when you like shut the TV, people discuss this, and then suddenly it's not a passive thing anymore. It's not something you watch. Then it becomes an active thing where you're discussing, oh, what happened? Did you see that? I hate that part. Can we not discuss horror shows on TV?
Why not? But that's half the fun of it.
I know, but like then it becomes, suddenly I'm like, oh, this is real.
Oh, by the way, another thing about this show I forgot to mention is I read an article after watching it saying that there were these screenshots of the frames, and there are throughout this entire show, there are ghosts just lurking at the back, and you can't even, like, there's so many that I have only missed out on. But when they've screenshotted them and shown them, and I've observed the frame, and I'm like, oh my god, there was a ghost, like, just...
Oh shit.
Interesting. Nice.
Thank you, Jana. What about you, Abbas? What did you watch?
I am also recommending something that's on Netflix. It's a Netflix original film. It's called Private Life. Wikipedia describes it as comedy drama, but I think it's a sad, happy kind of a film. So it's about a couple, a married couple who is in their mid to late 40s, and they're trying to have a kid, but the biological options are out. So now they're trying artificial means to have kids. And so the first about half an hour is just them dealing with this whole concept of, having a baby through IVF, like the amount of rounds they have to do of doctors, how the husband is treated in the situations, how the wife is treated in the situations, and the day-to-day sort of grind that they have to go through. So it's also funny in the sense of, like, the husband has to give the wife injections every day, right? So in a normal film or a TV show, when a woman is undressing, you think there's a sex scene coming, but here they're just undressing to give each other shots, right? So there's that, and then slowly as the movie goes along, they expand and they show the extended family of these couples, and then one thing leads to the other, and their niece comes to stay with them. Also, the couple is like a pretty upper class white couple. So the husband is an ex playwright, the wife writes books. So they're relatively wealthy and well to do.
Okay.
And they have a niece who's pursuing literature, so she likes to hang out with them more than her parents, because she sees them as her role models, because they're creative and they write books and plays and stuff. So they come, she lives with them, and then this idea strikes the couple, why don't we ask her to be the carrier of the child. Like, you know, you
how can old act, is she?
She's in her early
guys,
20s.
Oh my god. I thought first when you said niece, I thought like an 8-9-year-old girl.
She's the dilemma then becomes that the child that will actually grow inside Catherine Hahn's belly will actually be the kid of the girl and her husband. So how the family reacts and how, you know, that whole confusion happens. Oh. And I mean, they go to extreme lengths to tell you that they're not actually blood related. There are step siblings and step nieces and step aunts.
Okay.
So it's technically, if that child comes into the world, it won't be like incest.
Hmm.
They make fun of that as well.
Okay.
And then the rest of the film is about that. It's about how this one thing sort of makes the whole family dynamic uncomfortable.
Hmm.
But it's very well done. It actually focuses on, do you really need to be blood related to consider someone as family? You know, that's the kind of question it asks throughout. And I won't give the rest of the movie away. Certain things happen, but
do they finally have a baby? Is that a spoiler?
That would be a spoiler.
Okay. John, please don't.
Okay. The brightest part of the film is, of course, the couple is played by Paul Giamatti and Catherine Hahn. I mean, I've been a fan of Paul Giamatti for a long time. Like, he does understated comedy the best. And yeah, I mean, just the fact that you see two leads in a film who are in their 40s is really good. Is really nice, and the scenes between them are really nice. They do really well. The director of the film, Tamara Jenkins, this is actually her first film in 9 years.
Okay.
And she'd been going around shopping this script to various studios, and they all turned it down till Netflix picked it up and thought that this is something that that they would like to do.
So what did she do 9 years back? Like, what was
she was work? Making films. She made this film 9 years ago, which is also really good, called Savages.
Okay.
So Tamara Jenkins's forte is she takes these really small films where two protagonists take us through a journey.
Okay.
That's her forte. And she did some work here and there in TV, but this is her first film in 9 years. But it's very, very well shot, very nicely written. Some dialogues are really funny. So check it out. It's on Netflix. It's called Private Life. And yeah, that's my recommendation.
Nice. Thank you, Abbas. This movie is relatively new, what?
It came out like it came out in October.
Oh, okay. So there was no like theater release. It just came straight up.
I think there was a small theater release in the US, but that's about it. Yeah, it ran for like, I think, a week or two.
Nice.
Yeah.
But does this beat all the other movies you watched at the Mami?
It fits in very nicely with all the films I saw at Mami. Yeah.
Ooh, fun. Thank you, Buzz. Okay, I'm recommending a podcast. There's something I've been I got into this a month ago, and I binge listened to all the episodes. It's called Heavyweight. It's hosted by Jonathan Goldstein, who's a writer, who's also produced another podcast back. Now he works with the Gimlet Media, but used to work at This American Life. So he's been producing podcasts, and this new podcast is called Heavyweight. So it's basically, again, all the conversations that you regret not having, he kind of like basically makes it easier for you to talk about those things. Yeah. So one of the episodes, like, which was really like gripping, was about how a man who was hit by a car talks to the person who was driving the car after 4 years, and like both of their lives are changed dramatically. So this person who was driving the car has changed dramatically. He's super he's super anxious now. Mm-hmm. He's super like, you know, he's never really come out of that whole thing. And the man who was hit is also a different person. Like, now he doesn't part. Because like, now it's a comparison of how these people were before the accident and how, and them to, and when they actually meet, they're like the therapist, there's a therapist in the meeting and how the therapist was super against it. Their families were against them meeting after 4 years, but when they finally meet, it was such a healing process. Like, they both like hugged each other. It was very like you don't, like, I wasn't looking, like, you just can't predict what's going to come out of this. And another episode was about this son and mother. Basically, I think it's called it's called Sky. Yeah, so basically it's about a mother who, when she was in middle school, her best friend showed up at her home, and they basically, you know what's a teepee?
Toilet paper.
Yeah, they teepeed a backyard or whatever, their toilet paper, and they wrote you on a garage door. And she never understood why. And then the best friends never came. She changed schools, and she never confronted them.
Okay.
And after all this time, and she has a son now, he knows the story. And the son keeps asking her mother, why did you not ask them?
Hmm.
Why did you not stand up for yourself? What did you do? So after all these years, she talks to her best friends back in the day. And kind of like now the son looks up to her mom in a way that she's not a meek person, you know. She can stand up for herself. So that was also a very nice episode. Yeah,
I like the one where Jonathan takes his dad to meet his uncle.
His
dad's brother. They haven't spoken to each other in years. So this actually, I mean, when I listen to these episodes, it's like, I always wonder how does he convince the people in the room to let him record them
exactly
in these moments. So yeah, it's called Heavyweight. It's pretty heavy with emotions and stuff, but yeah.
But also he makes it fun.
He makes it so much fun. Jonathan Goldstein, the way he talks, how awkward he is with everything. It's really funny.
He makes it really fun, and then he also keeps talking about Alex Bloomberg, who works at the Convent office. So again, it's called Heavyweight, but it's like a fun, like the way he narrates a story and the way he gets around this is super like fun.
Yeah.
And yeah, the second season is out now. And like, even though the first season was mostly about his life and his stories and how basically his family, but now he's branching out to like real people and their lives.
If you had to like recommend one episode, which one?
My favorite one was called Rob. It's the one where Rob, this guy, he broke his arm as a kid. But the rest of his family does not remember.
Okay.
They say it never happened. And then it's super funny. This is the funniest episode, I feel. So Rob is like questioning his own sanity now throughout the episode. Did this happen? Was I like doing this for attention? And okay, I won't tell you what happens. But like really listen to this episode. It's called, it's episode number 16.
Okay.
Rob. Yeah, so this was a recommendation round. We will now do a quick recap. Janam?
I recommended the TV show The Haunting of Hill House. It's on Netflix.
I recommended a Netflix original film called Private Life.
I recommended a podcast called Heavyweight. And we'll see you after the break.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure that you are. We are IVM Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. I have a little bit of news for people. We are releasing a new version of our app, and as part of that, we're running a beta program. We have about 40 slots left for different users to participate in the beta program, and if you'd be interested in doing that, please go to our website, ivmpodcast.com/appbeta. That's ivmpodcast.com/appbeta. Over there, you'll be find a form which will let you submit your email address to us and we'll invite you into the beta. Again, it's a limited availability, so we're only going to be able to invite so many people. But if you're interested, please do subscribe. And this week on Cyrus Says, Cyrus talks to stand-up comedian Saurabh Mehta about moving from HR to comedy and positioning himself as a first giant stand-up comic. On Simplify this week, the guys talk to Atul Churamani of Magna Sound about the golden age of indie pop in the 90s. On the season finale of the Kinetic Living podcast, Coach Urmi spoke to fellow NTC trainer Kunal Rajput, and they talk about kettlebell sports, powerlifting, and how his dad, a Mumbai-based bodybuilder, inspired him to pursue his fitness career. And starting November 19th, we have a very exciting project. We're starting our first history project with Anirudh Kanisetti. It's called Echoes of India. Please do catch it on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from. And with that, let's continue on with your show.
Hey guys, welcome back to IVM Likes. We're back. Abbas and I, Janam had to leave. Janam had to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, we shot her. No, just kidding.
We didn't shoot her. We just sent her away. Like, we have a lot of work to do.
No, it's not work. It's actually because since we are discussing homecoming and she hasn't seen either the TV show or the podcast. So again, spoiler warning for you guys. If you haven't heard the show and if you're meaning to listen to the podcast, just do not.
Either do not or just be okay with the fact that we spoiled it for you and you're still going to watch it.
If I were you, I'd be okay with it and listen to the episode, honestly. So, let's get into it. Abbas, you heard the podcast.
Yeah, so a couple of weeks ago, me and Surbhi decided that she actually asked me a question that if one medium is being converted into a movie, would you rather read the book or watch the movie? And I was like, probably read the book or listen to the podcast. And she was like, no, I'd rather go watch the movie or the TV show. And then obviously Homecoming, which is an Amazon Prime original, is based on a podcast, which is also called Homecoming. So we decided I'll listen to the podcast, she'll watch the show, and then we'll have a discussion on this on IVM Likes about basically compare and contrast. So yeah, I heard the podcast. It's 12 episodes. I finished the whole thing in 2 days.
Are you meaning to watch the show? I mean, you're okay.
I am actually.
But you're okay with spoilers, right?
Yeah, I'm okay with spoilers because I kind of know the crux of the show. Unless they gave a really big spin on something.
No, it's not a big spin. It's a very small
show. Have you heard the podcast though?
I've not. I've heard the first 3 episodes.
Okay, cool.
But immediately when I was listening to the podcast, I saw literal billboards. I was in the cab listening to Homecoming and I saw Amazon Now Homecoming. I was like, wait a second. So I was like, I'd rather watch the show. Even the show was really gripping, but again, it's a show that...
Let's do first impressions. Okay. I'll tell you my first impression of the podcast. You can tell me.
Yeah.
So overall, I liked the show. I think, obviously, it was very well produced. I was a little surprised by the fact that they actually used A-list, pretty much Hollywood A-listers
for
the podcast.
Yeah.
You have David Schwimmer, you have Oscar Isaac, you have Catherine Keener, and you have David Cross, and Michael Cera does a little cameo, you know. So I was very impressed with the voice cast they had. And I think they all do a very good job. Like, when I hear David Schwimmer, I'm not listening to Ross. I'm actually listening to the character that he's playing on the episode. But So I have two grouses to pick with the podcast. One was that for the first 2 or 3 episodes, there's a reason why we're listening to this. Either someone's recording something or someone's playing a telephone call or some sort of something's playing over a speaker. And this is why there's a sense of why we're listening to this. As the podcast goes on, that aspect of it goes away. Now you're just listening to two people in a room talking to each other.
Oh, okay.
And we're not given any explanation why we're listening to this. So I was a little let down by that. And over the course of 12 episodes, so the podcast was split into two halves of 6 and 6 episodes. And I thought the second half was much weaker than the first one. I think the first 6 episodes really grip you. They did a very good job of building the suspense and, you know, slowly revealing what happened. But the next 6 episodes, I think because they had to reach a conclusion, they kind of rushed through it.
Okay.
So, yeah.
That's the first impression of the podcast.
Right.
Briefly, I'll tell you what Homecoming is about. Homecoming is based on a home project called The Homecoming, which was designed to cure military veterans of their PTSD by erasing troubling memories and getting them ready in top shape to return to war. So this was what the Homecoming project was about, but again, a lot more because things go awry and the medicine that they're using to treat PTSD also deletes memories.
Normal memories
that you have. So that's the show. Again, my first, I think, impressions of the show was super, like the first 5 episodes, I was super gripped. Like, I couldn't stop watching.
So the TV show is how many episodes?
10 episodes.
Okay.
And
also,
another thing that makes the show different from the podcast is the podcast. So basically, there are 2 major characters again. Heidi is the therapist.
Right.
And Walter Cruz is another major character. He is a military veteran at the establishment called Homecoming.
Who she's counseling.
Yeah. So in the podcast, they don't actually meet. Throughout the whole full seasons,
we hear them in flashbacks.
Yeah, they don't reunite.
Right.
Yeah. So this is something.
In the show they do?
Yeah.
Okay.
In the show they do. And again, I read about this. So again, you know what? When you're watching a show, there's been so much build up and I've spent so much time already watching the whole show. I need to have a conclusion. If they did this thing where if the show was, you know, somehow in the 10th episode, if they just left us hanging, I would be so disappointed. So
I was particularly disappointed by that. In the podcast, what they do is they kind of leave it hanging of a possibility that they may reunite.
I feel like the medium does make a difference because when I'm watching one particular season, I would want some kind of conclusion to arrive. So I think that's one difference.
Okay.
Also, it's directed very well.
Okay.
Like there are also another thing that makes the podcast different from the TV show is in the TV show, again, 2 timelines, that's the same.
Right.
But how it works is, because again, we're dealing with 2 timelines. So one timeline is 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And one timeline is the current picture.
Okay.
So basically, if you watch the TV show, the current picture is the 1:1 ratio. Like it's not the full screen.
Mm-hmm.
And in the
flashback,
it's full.
Okay.
It's full this thing.
aspect ratio, the full picture, wide screen.
Yeah, and I read the reasoning behind this. It's because in the current image, Heidi is not understanding a full picture. Like, she's very confused.
Got it.
Because there is the CEO of Geist, and she has all these questions. Right. She's still putting it to place, and she's still, like, you know, struggling to find, like, what's the full picture.
Right.
And then so there's a moment in the show when it finally comes together.
When it becomes widescreen?
No, yeah, when it all becomes widescreen. So there's a moment at the, around 8th episode? Yeah, around the 8th episode, it all comes down to her because she gets a triggering memory. And that's when the aspect ratio changes. So I feel like there was some of these, like, very tiny things that they added to the show really made it, like, a very gripping show.
Got it. Cool. What did you think of Julia Roberts?
She was very good, dude. I feel like she really played the role of a vulnerable... Like, I would... Like, I couldn't, like, obviously, it wasn't super relatable. I was like, but again, the way she portrayed this character, I feel like she was super vulnerable, and she did a good job of playing that character, is what I feel. Like, not even once was like, oh, she's, you know, like how Colin, the character, throughout things, she's faking it, or whatever, what she's doing. Like, he's super confused about what she's doing. But as the audience, I am always, like, on her side. I was like, hey, I know, like, something's wrong. Like,
so what did you think of Colin's character arc? Like, so in the podcast, you start off hating Colin because he's her supervisor and he's always on her, behind her, saying she's not doing something correctly.
In the beginning of the podcast, I also didn't hate Colin much because I was like, so in the beginning, I didn't hate Colin much because also... She was also giving into his demands, right?
Somewhere towards the middle, there is a point in the podcast. I don't know if that's how they did it on a TV show, where both of them are competing to reach the guy.
Walter Cruz.
Walter. They're both trying to find Walter. And then it becomes a case of one-upmanship of...
They didn't do that.
Okay, so in the podcast, that's when Colin tries tries all the dirty tricks to get there first. And then... Eventually, they realize that they can only get to him once they collaborate. So then you kind of try and get on Colin's side. But I was very impressed with the way David Schwimmer has played Colin on the podcast. One of the reasons why I don't almost feel like going to the TV show is because I want that aspect of Colin's character to be there. I don't know how the actor Bobby Cannavale has done
Bobby
on
Cannavale
the show.
Did a good job also, but he... I think you're right about how he did. Like, I think around episode 3, you kind of think of him as a villain.
Because he's portrayed that way.
He's portrayed as a villain, yeah. But I can't... So are you saying that they never reunited in the podcast?
Colin and Heidi?
No. Just Walter Cruz
and
Heidi.
Is there
a mom character?
There is a mom character,
Walter Cruz's mom.
Yeah.
And also Heidi's mom.
No, there is no Heidi's mom.
Heidi's mom.
There is no Heidi mom on the podcast. Is there?
Yeah, she's there. I've heard the first
episode. She's in a hospital. She's in an old age home sort of a situation. Yeah, she is. Yeah. But yeah, the conclusion, they kind of leave it as an open ending, as a possibility. So I read somewhere that the TV show also doesn't completely tell you what happens I read somewhere that it's like the ending of Inception, where it's you make it how you want to be, like the top is spinning and you, whichever way you think of it is the ending you will see.
You're right, but I also think it's much clearer than that. Like, there's more clarity to this ending than the Inception ending.
All right.
Because again, like, they, I think Heidi's aim at the end of the show is just getting to, like, just meeting Walter Cruz and finding out if he's okay. Because she doesn't know where he is and what's happening to Walter Cruz. So, Heidi, even just the act of meeting Walter Cruz and seeing that he's okay, he's living in a tiny town, by the way.
Okay, they show you all of this.
Yeah, they show all of this. So basically, you know the whole... Is there a mention
the podcast,
of Yosemite?
I think there is. In the podcast, it's what we hear is that Walter is actually... He's joined a cult. And he's living with a cult somewhere in the mountains, and then Heidi and Colin actually go. Heidi and Colin go and try and find him.
Oh my god!
And then in the end, we never really told whether he actually joined the cult or
what cult.
Yeah. We never actually told what the cult does, but we just told that Walter has been sending his mom some voice notes through a phone, and we hear his voice notes, and then we try and imagine where
he is. I feel
like
that's the difference that you have to take as a medium, because you like while watching the TV show, also I was thinking like there were such elaborate scenes where just Heidi just looking into the window. I'm like, this can't be exact copy from the podcast. Like, you can't just have 5 minutes of Heidi and then I looked out of the window for five straight minutes. So I feel like this is something that you maybe take, maybe the director took the call as, but like, I'll just quickly tell you what happens in the end.
Okay.
No, he doesn't join a cult in the episode.
There's no mention of a cult at all.
There's no mention of a cult, which was, I was taken aback.
That's surprising. Oh.
Basically, Walter Cruz, when he was at the homecoming, he mentions road tripping to Yosemite a lot.
Okay.
So, when her memory comes back, when Heidi's memory triggers back through that, when it comes back, she immediately tries to, go back to Walter Cruz. Okay. And then she obviously takes a road trip to Yosemite. And then she finds him. He has built his own, small deck.
Okay.
And he's working on it. And then she's waiting in a diner when Walter Cruz walks in. And obviously, he's lost his memory, so he doesn't remember. But they still have a conversation.
No, this something similar to this happens with another character in the podcast who Heidi tries to find out through him where Walter might be. But yeah, Heidi and Walter never meet in the in the podcast.
That's so true.
So I'm very curious to know Colin also has a supervisor, right? And she has an assistant.
How
is that done in the
TV
show?
That is super. Okay, I think the show spent over 6 minutes on that.
That's it?
Yeah. That's it. And it also comes after the credits. I remember this is literally after the show is ending. This comes out of the credit. Like, this is a post-credit scene.
Okay.
And we find out that Colin tries to get back into, whatever, the Geist company. But this, I can't remember who played this character on the show. But I remember that this wasn't, except it just left the viewers with the thing of hey, you can come back with a season 2, but with no mention of. I have a feeling if they come back with the season 2, there'll be no Walter Cruz or Heidi. It'll just be about Geist and about
something
Colin.
Something else, yeah.
Because Colin also, you have a lot of questions because, of course, even though he is a major part of Geist, he also has seniors and people who've been, pushing this.
Actually, in the podcast, there is this running gag between Colin and the assistant, because every time he calls her to get through to his supervisor, she always makes him do something different to verify that it's actually Colin.
Oh, really?
So sometimes she'll make him sing the national anthem, sometimes she'll make him do the ABCD and repeatedly. So there's always that running gag throughout the show.
That's amazing. That and again, this is something that only a podcast can do, because it's only, a voice.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, man. That's very interesting how they picked up a format and changed it to. Wait, so I just remembered Geist Group's Aubrey Temple is played by Hong Chao. And she was privately. So basically, again, when Colin enters the room, enters the conference room, he's like, there's a tension kind of situation. And that's when she breaks it to him that he's been fired and he's not in a position to But again, it's left already.
Is there a boyfriend character for Heidi in the show?
Oh my God.
Who plays it on the show?
There is no boyfriend. There's a boyfriend character. Okay, in the beginning. In the beginning, and she's not very nice to Heidi.
Exactly,
not very nice to him.
And he doesn't come back.
He does come back. But that Heidi just wants to get him back to know what she's forgotten. Because she has no memory of this guy.
So then I think the second half of the show, I have to see the show, because I think the parts of the podcast in the second half, which I thought were weak, what you described, have course corrected it.
Colin comes back in Heidi's life. They go to a diner. Is there a scene where they go to a diner?
Yeah, there is a scene in the podcast where they go to a diner,
And Colin is the guy who basically Heidi doesn't know this guy is Colin.
No, she knows in the podcast that it's Colin.
Oh my God. Okay.
Yeah, they do.
Colin and Heidi sleep together because Heidi has no idea who this person is. So they go out on a date with Heidi doesn't know who Colin is because she's forgotten all her memories.
Right.
So Colin literally only to gauge how much she knows and how much she does not know.
Okay.
He pretends to be like someone who cares about her.
He does it on the podcast as well, but they don't sleep on the podcast because I think it won't be very.
Not the problem of the medium. It's the medium that's the problem.
It's the medium. Can't show people sleeping together.
I really think you should listen. You should watch the show also because the show. I mean, even though there are small, tiny changes, but it kind of like gives you more of a closure, I think, in the show. It doesn't leave you hanging. So I feel like the show is quite cool.
And they have, are there plans for a season 2?
I think there's a plan, because again the show ends, you know, like even
ambiguous.
I think again the show, though, if the second season comes along, it'll be about Geist as a organization, because we never got into it and why they do all these things. And maybe if Walter Cruz's mom, is there a scene in the podcast where Walter Cruz's mom discovers how Geist is a company who makes shampoo and all these things?
So that's an aspect also.
That's an aspect.
Yeah, again, see, the TV show has much more luxury to show how vast their reach is rather than the podcast.
At what part in the podcast did like Walter Cruz's mom start to realize that there's something wrong with the organization?
So like I said, there is a point where both Heidi and Colin are trying to get to Walter, right?
I want to know, at what point did they realize that there is something wrong in the medicine? And because I remember Heidi also did not realize for the longest time, but Walter Cruz's mom started questioning. And
Walter Cruz's mom comes in the podcast only in the second half, whereas Heidi starts realizing. So there's this policeman character who goes to the diner where Heidi's working as a waitress. Who in the podcast, he's the one actually who tries to trigger.
He's not the policeman. He's like a person who works for the Department of Government. I know, some government.
Some official kind of person. And yeah, I think it's through him that she kind of starts remembering things. What exactly happened. Oh yeah, in the podcast, they have the tapes that Heidi made during the counseling sessions.
Yeah, they do.
And
too.
They play it for her, and that's how she starts to remember stuff.
Same. I think in this also, the tapes kind of help her. But again, very different from each other. Very different from each other. But
especially
fun.
The second half. Yeah, now I'm curious to see how they course corrected the stuff that I didn't like.
And also a bonus sleeping scene.
Yeah.
That too. But yeah, that was Homecoming.
Yeah.
It's on podcast and on Amazon Prime.
I think Alex Bloomberg is the Gimlet CEO, right?
CEO.
So he does this other podcast where he interviews entrepreneurs, and he did, I think, 3 or 4.
It's called Startup, right?
Startup, So he did a 4-episode arc of how Homecoming became a TV show.
Oh my God,
so you should listen to
that's
that
very
as well.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I could listen to that. Yeah, and also I feel like Julia Roberts.
Do you see this happening more often now? Podcasts eventually becoming
maybe,
TV shows,
but I don't. I'll be super confused. Do you think they should? Again, I feel like it's a liberty, like it's a creative liberty, like the director can take on how to
cue
things.
It's the same as a book becoming into a movie, right?
Yeah. But then again, if more podcasts become into TV shows, there'll be more like comparisons.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, part of me almost wanted this in the star cast of the podcast to be on the TV. But then I realized
amazing.
The cast of the TV show is actually much more diverse. Like they've made one character African American. They've cast an Asian woman.
Yeah.
So I think they were very particular about that in casting more diverse people.
That's pretty cool. That's actually pretty cool. Sam Ismail is the director, right?
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's pretty fun. But yeah, you can watch this show and
or
you can also listen to the
podcast.
Or you can, once you remember that, you can listen to how the podcast
became the show.
This was fun. Maybe we'll have more of these episodes. So
which one of our podcasts do you see becoming a movie?
Yeah, is it this one? Is it this one right now?
If IVM Likes becomes a movie, who would you like to see being played? Who would play Abbas and Surbhi and Janam and so many other people?
Yeah, let us know. You can reach out to us on IVM Podcast. We are on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook.
Yep.
And you can also reach out to us personally, Abbas.
You can reach me on Twitter. I am at Abbas Momin, and on Instagram, I am Abbas Momin 88.
You can reach out to me on Instagram at Surbhi Bhaka. You can also reach out to me on Twitter at Small Talk Police. This was another episode of IVM Likes. Hope you guys had fun. And hope we see you soon. I guess.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Take care.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are about to listen to attempt number 15 to record the promo for the podcast Varta Lab.
Varta Lab.
Varta Lab.
Varta Lab.
Varta Lab.
All day, all night, Varta Lab.
Oh, yeah. It's a really nice podcast, guys. It's with me and Naveen, and it has really nice stories.
Yeah, people come, tell their stories, ups and downs, fun times. We all cry at the end. It's like a Karan Johar movie, but in 1 hour or less.
Hey.
Yeah, every Monday. Yeah. It's got humans.
Have you gotten yourself a gym membership and shown up only a few times? Are long working hours cutting your fitness goals short? How about you change things a little? Even a small effort can make a big difference. And I'll tell you how and what exactly. Hi guys, I'm Coach Urmi, and on the Kinetic Living podcast, you can look forward to some interesting stories of people who have changed the way they look at fitness after their kinetic journeys. Episodes out every Wednesday on the IVM app, website, and anywhere you get your podcast from.